off the clicking sound on their phone, you know, when they're texting. Just turn it off. It's so annoying. Just mute it.
But you know,
I hate when people don't turn off the clicking sound on their phone, you know, when they're texting.
I don't know how to speak like that, but I know you're fucking. I know he has some I don't know what it is, bro. I want to watch that show so bad. But it's probably some, like, really fucking fucked up accent shit he has to say. Anyways.
Actually work.
Shut the fuck
up. If cartoon characters were real.
That's beautiful. Damn. Tall and thin and young and lovely. The girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, it's when she passes. Tall and thin and young and lovely. The girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, it's when she passes. On the morning of August 22nd, 1987, a masked man known only by his moniker, Mr. Cruel, broke into a family's home in a quiet suburb of Lower Pulteney, on the outskirts of Melbourne, Australia. He forced both parents onto their stomachs, bound their hands and feet, and locked them into a closet. Then he tied their 7-year-old son to a bed and attacked the 11-year-old daughter. He cut the phone lines and left. The intruder then embarked on a sadistic abduction spree that saw 4 Melbourne children disappear until 1991, but no one could stop Mr. Cruel because no one could identify him. On that Australian winter morning in 1987, Mr. Cruel established himself as the boogeyman that would strike fear into parents and children alike for over a decade. After the twisted attack on the family in Lower Plenty, the police were called and their investigation began. The family told him that after detaching on a pane from their living room window, the black-clad criminal had made his way into the parents' room, clutching a knife in one hand and a gun in the other. To sedate them, the intruder utilized the type of knot most commonly used by sailors, or at least those with some nautical experience. Over the course of the next 2 hours, Mr. Cruel raped the 11-year-old daughter. When he finally left, he pilfered a box of records and blue jacket. The little girl eventually able to tell police that the intruder used the family phone to call someone else during one of his break-ins, attacking her. But the girl heard this call was threatening, one with the man demanding the person on the other end of the line to move their children or they would be next. And he referred to this unknown person as Bozo. Police then checked the family phone records, but there was no record of this car whatsoever. It would later become clear that this was Mr. Cruel's planting a red herring to purposely confuse investigators. He would successfully throw them off his scent for years. He also kidnapped and molested 4 other girls. Until this day, they don't know who he is. Damn it. Let's see if any of this is true. Man, German and half Danish is half embarrassing and half fucking impressive at the same time. Gotten Morgan Kinder. Watch you off. You scared me, bro.
Day and sing this little song. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit.
Run, run, run.
Run, rabbit, run, rabbit.
Run, run, run.
Run, run, run.
Please don't go.
Science experiments that went wrong. Experiment.
What do you do for a living? I point to the ceiling while glaring at the camera. Oh, I get it.
Student in the class.
You have a gift.
This house on memories.
Read my picture now. Shake until you see it. And when your fantasies become your legacy, promise me a place.
What it was exactly. The following is going to be a Japanese girl from Ruka was cheerful, studious, kind, and she never went drinking or partying. She was admired in her school. She was very beautiful. There was a boy, Hiroshi Minyo, who liked her. He was the class bully. He went to Junko with her proposal, but Junko denied this proposal up front. Hiroshi could not get the rejection from her. Made him furious. He decided to take revenge on her on November 25th. He had a part-time job on her bike. A random boy passed her and made her fall. Minyo went to her, though helping her, but then in no time before Junko realized what was happening, Minyo, along with his three friends, kidnapped Junko. They took Junko to a house in Hitachi, Tokyo, which was owned by one of the kidnapper's parents. The parents knew this was happening, but they took no action because they were scared, as one of the kidnappers were in close contact with the Japanese mafia group. When she was kidnapped, her parents were worried and started a search for her. So the boys made Junko call her parents thrice and say that she ran away, she was safe, and that she would be staying with some of her friends for a while. Furuto was raped every single day, multiple times a day. She was raped by other Yakuza members, as well as the four kidnappers. Members were invited. She was forced to masturbate, eat live cockroaches, and drink her urine as an entertainment for those men. Overall, she was raped more than 900 times. They also invited a gang of over 100 men each day to rape her and urinate on her. Only one man, seeing her conditions, felt disturbed, so he called the police. The police came, but the parents who lived below refused any girl being in the house, and the police didn't care. He was assaulted in other ways too, including being annually raped with a bottle and fireworks and having to steal light bulb inserted into her vagina, placed inside of her vagina. They also inserted metal rod inside her privates after 11 days of torture. Pain, her brain only knew one thing, pain about her sleeping place. They forced her to sleep on a balcony wearing a rag. I remember when this happened, it was a month or so. All the suffering here and the cause of torture was very humane. They put her with cigarettes and candlelights all over her body, had her hands and nails smashed by waves, beat her with sticks and clubs, and stomped on her. The men hung Furuta from the ceiling and used her to punch and bat until her damaged internal organs made blood run through from her mouth. Whenever they got bored of her, they would lock her in the freezer for hours and take her out again. When they wanted to torture her, she was like a toy to them. They even flexed to their male friends about having a woman to themselves. After 30 days, Uncle Furuta could not urinate properly due to damage to internal organs and the vulva from insertion of foreign objects and burns from cigarettes and lighters. Her hands over her her hands and feet were damaged severely, and it took her over an hour to crawl downstairs to the bathroom. Her eardrums were also damaged, and her brain size was reduced. She was also force-fed large amounts of alcohol, milk, and water so that she had to use the washroom more often. They enjoyed watching her crawl downstairs to the washroom. So much pain when she was inattentively hurt. It took her over an hour to reach downstairs. Sometimes when she was forced to drink large amounts of water, they didn't let her go. The washroom made her drink her own urine. While she was only a quarter through her ordeal, owing to ongoing beatings, Junko Furuto could not breathe through her nose due to the accumulation of blood in her cavities. Her traumatized internal organs refused to accept food or water, so when she tried to drink, she instantly vomited, which kept her more dehydrated. Also agitated the perpetrators, who punished her with more beatings for soiling the carpet. They forced her to dance to music naked. They used needles to drill a series of holes in her body. The cruel boys even burned her genitals, clitoris, and eyelid with a lighter. One of the nipples was twisted with pliers. With so many injuries all over her body, Junko couldn't even stand from the pain. She had to crawl downstairs to use the bathroom. 2 weeks in, Furuta managed to call the cops, but before she was able to say anything, the boys discovered her when the police called back. Miura assured them that the prior call had been a mistake and punished her for violating the rule. The captor soaked her in lighter fluid and set her on fire twice. Despite having a seizure, she lived through the attack, but could not live through a third burning, which was not as a punishment for winning in the game they forced her to play. When she won the game, they not only set her body on fire, but beat her brutally with iron weights. They covered her hands in plastic as blood and pus was coming out immensely from them, and threw a large iron ball on her stomach. She died after 4 hours of this happening. Finally, Hiroshi Minato was sentenced to 17 years. Shinyo Minato was sentenced to 5 years ago and served 8 years in Gotcha. They're 5 years by now. Each of them has been released from jail. They changed their names and are living their lives happily and free. And if you're wondering what they did to her body, they threw her body in a drum and filled it with concrete for 2 months. The body remained in the drum until it was found. The guy who proposed her and planned all this out put on tape on the drum with the title of an anime manga. Manga with Junko. It is Charles. She really used the last of the book to never watch it. And he wrote the name on his drum, not because he liked her, but because he wanted her soul to not haunt him. Also, when all this happened, her birthday was only a few days away. When she died, a memorial was held for her by her school. All girls cried, all her friends cried, all her entire school cried. Her mom received a mental shock. She couldn't show her face in the cabinet. She walked away. She was crying. She couldn't stop crying either. I remember this intelligent, young, modest, brave, kind girl who never liked dating. Or drinking or partying, Furuto's torches don't even end at her bed death. When the four boys are sent to jail, one of the boys' mothers was furious on Furuto, and so she destroys Furuto's grave because, according to her, Furuto ruined her son's life.
The worst part remains one of the kidnappers actually married and has a young daughter. I am afraid for this girl's life. I bet the woman was forced to marry him. Rest in peace.
Jesus fucking Christ.
I think that's gotta wrap it up. It's 10 o'clock. I'm tired. That was fucked up.
Good night, yeah.